We're speaking with Donna Neville and George Bershot. I am curious because obviously BDS is probably the line that a lot of moderates who are open to change feel that is not the line that they're willing to cross. Can you talk about the possibility of unintended consequences? Now, obviously, we saw that BDS is ultimately what broke, you know, the apartheid in South Africa. I'm curious as to how you feel there may be unintended consequences if there was a full-on attempt to push a BDS movement. That seems to be the greatest pushback that I see. Not from the, you know, the Orthodox community. You know, they're not going to be in favor of anything that changes anything. I'm talking about the people who are open to the idea of change, but they feel that BDS may be a bridge too far.
Well, you know, so let me be clear. I don't think that BDS, first of all, BDS is a tactic, right? It is not a strategic end. And it seeks certain ends. It seeks, you know, equal rights for Palestinian citizens of Israel into occupation and right of return. Those are the three basic demands of the BDS movement. I actually think that the BDS movement needs to take the next step and actually define what its end goal is, because I think part of the fear and suspicion surrounding it is that it harbors annihilationist intentions, and it doesn't. What I really think is called for at this particular time is something like a freedom charter, like the ANC issued for South Africa, in which it specifies, you know, clearly what, you know, what the future is going to look like. And I think that future has to be a political arrangement which is based on justice and equal rights for everybody. And I happen to believe, for various reasons which I could explain, that the best framework for doing that is within one single state. I don't believe you can, I mean, you know, we've been wrestling with the idea of partition of Palestine since 1937, when the Peel Commission issued a report that was the first recommendation of dividing the country. We've been, you know, trying this game for 85 years, 84 years, unsuccessfully, right? And so there isn't going to be, there never will be a partition of Palestine that's, or Israel-Palestine, that will be satisfactory and that will be accepted by everybody. And moreover, I would say, you know, the objective of two states is itself not a morally compelling one. I think one of the reasons that that the two-state solution has been unsuccessful is because nobody really wants it. You know, you've got 2 million, almost 2 million Palestinian citizens of Israel who, if they remained in a Jewish state, would remain second-class citizens. It would be as if we said, okay, let's stop slavery in, you know, in 2 out of the 11 Confederate states. How's that? We'll let state, you know, the slaves be free in 2 out of the 11 Confederate states. Well, if the idea is of having an ethnic state for one people in a country that's mixed, it's illegitimate everywhere, not just, you know, so, and I guarantee you that 700,000 Jewish settlers on the West Bank are never going to be moved. You show me, you tell me the political power that is ever going to be capable of moving them. And if they're not moved, there's no Palestinian state, okay? What has happened within Israel in May of this year and earlier, back in 2008, you know, after the withdrawal of Jewish settlers from the Gaza Strip, there are only 8,500 of them, right? They managed to move them and relocate them. Some of them relocated in cities within Israel with large Arab concentrations, with the specific aim of basically breaking, Judaizing those places like Akka. And we had what Israeli officials called in 2008 pogroms against Arabs. And part of what was going on this last May was, you know, was a response of Palestinians within Israel to displacement, just like what everybody saw going on in Sheikh Jarrah, what was going on in Lod, what was going on in Jaffa, what was going on in Akka and Haifa, all those places. same kind of thing. So, you know, I think, and I'll just stop with this, I think one of the unacknowledged functions of settlement for Israel is actually diffusing social tensions within the Jewish population of Israel. You know, it has mitigated class tensions by providing, you know, relatively cheap housing for people who wouldn't otherwise be able to afford it. And it has separated the, you know, the libertine, you know, Tel Aviv from the conservative parts of the country and in the West Bank and the settlements, where the religious nationalists are mostly concentrated. And I guarantee you they're never going to be brought back together. If there were, there would be civil war within Israel itself between Jews, not just, you know, against Palestinians.
There were just two things I was thinking about when George was talking. One was that there's an Israeli organization called Zohrot, means remembering, and it and a Palestinian organization, Badil, they have come together and they've done a lot of work on looking at the practicalities of return and to show how very possible it is. And the other thing, in your question about BDS, what I was thinking about is that, again, for those of us who are trying to, you know, really act with integrity on this issue, it's real. If you really understand the right of return, and it's hard to then make some of the arguments that people make. If you really understand that history, when I first got involved with this issue, I mean, I'm now in my mid 60s, when I was, you know, in my early 20s, I entered in 1967. So I was against the occupation of 1967, but I didn't yet understand what had happened in leading up to 48. Once you know that history, I think that it's, and part of the reason I think it's so important to know that history is the right of return becomes much more understood. And I think, so to me, I just wanted to say that I think that's part of our work too, is to actually get to the roots and get to that foundation. And I think then you're having a very different kind of conversation when some of these questions come up. If that makes sense.
You know? No, it does. I think back to like my dad and even my grandmother and this idea that if we allowed all the Arabs to come there and then there would cease to be a Jewish state and then they would kill all the Jews. And it's like this very fear-mongery, like you said, propagandized campaign that I mean, I grew up in North Miami Beach, which is the second like largest Jewish ghetto in this country outside of Brooklyn. So there was no two sides of this story at all. So, you know, we have a very older population here. Well, Donna, you know, you're fairly local.
But it's changed. I grew up here and then I left for 35 years and lived in Manhattan and now I'm back and I can say, look, we just had the protests have been thousands of people in support of Palestine on the streets of Miami.
It definitely has changed. Yeah. We are speaking.
Thanks for watching. If you want to support our mission to transform politics into service, please like this video, subscribe, follow us on social media, and consider joining our Patreon, where you'll get early access to our interviews as well as other exclusive content. Links are in the description. Peace out.